It's over. AI is evolving at an alarming rate. Programmers are becoming obsolete. The market is becoming oversaturated. Layoffs are happening left and right. Tech bubble is seemingly about to burst. We, as programmers, are on the brink of becoming an endangered existence. Our livelihoods close to enter the history books as a closed chapter. Unless we act. Fast. To fight back this seemingly unstoppable evolution of the landscape, we have to adapt, make use of our innate advantages as a species, and enter a space where no computer can intrude, our conscious. With sticks, stones, ink and paper, we're granted an equalizer in this confrontation that would make even Napoleon cower in fear. Because what else have humans excelled at since the dawn of time, if not rejecting progress until it generates cold hard cash? As such, I bring forth the new weapon of choice for the first line of defense. A paper compiler, as in a compiler that runs any code using only your handwriting on a piece of paper. And you may think, oh, so you mean using our brains to write out the output of each instruction in a sequence simulating a compiler? To which I respond, of course not, silly, I don't trust myself to navigate a single instruction without a debugger. What makes you think I'm such a masochist I'd do something like this willingly? No. What I mean by a paper compiler is ignoring all the stuff I've said at the start of the video and using all the available newest shiny tools our AI overlords offer to create an app that allows me to photograph snippets of code along with their inputs, if needed, and get back a picture with the output following running the code. Generated using my own handwriting, for no other reason than I think it's cool and wanna show off something I found out the other day. There will be two main components to this project. A mobile app that allows registering a user with its handwriting and taking pictures of code snippets and their inputs, displaying internal response with the compilation result. And an API which will process these requests from the app, making use of multiple technologies and services, which I'll describe in detail later on. And because graphic design is my passion, fact cemented by future me confirming it took as much time to create the API as it took to create a basic Flutter app, I began by creating the API. Because I figured there would be like 2 or 3 endpoints necessary for the entire thing, I opted for using Fast API. Because it's fast, and creates APIs fast. And in bish bash posh, I can now send requests to a register endpoint, a compiled one, and one providing available compile languages. Of course, as a user and as a human being, you probably detest being left on read and would much prefer to have your request produce some kind of meaningful responses. So, because it relates to both the register and the compile endpoints, it was time to figure out how to parse images to text. The response was OCR, or Optical Character Recognition, meaning the conversion of images of type, handwritten or printed text, into machine-encoded text, whether from a scanned document, a photo of a document, a scene photo, for example the text on signs and billboards, or from subtitle text superimposed on an image. This is a vast domain in which fragile little me is no match for the fellas in the big leagues. So I'll do as the small man does and simply comply with the wishes of the big man, and choose an already implemented solution. Quick pit stop, but I really want to thank you guys for the support you've been showing in the past few weeks. And to hopefully keep this trend up, and because it apparently works, I'll just give you a quick nod to like and subscribe. And again, thank you so much. Question now is, which one do I choose? After a bit of investigation, the 4 major big hitters, at least from what my limited knowledge managed to gather, are Tesseract, developed by Hewlett-Packard in the 80s, yes, the 80s, then taken by Google under its wing in 2006, EasyOCR, a Python package using PyTorch under the hood developed by Jaded AI and released in 2019, PaddleOCR, developed by PaddlePaddle, which is a Chinese deep learning platform open sourced since 2016, that is similar to Google's TensorFlow or Meta's PyTorch, and finally MMOCR, which, no, isn't the newest World of Warcraft competitor, but instead one of the newest successful entries in the OCR sphere, a toolkit for text detection, recognition and understanding, developed by OpenMM Lab, released in 2020, and since gaining a large user base due to its qualitative results. From the limited testing concerning my very specific use case, as well as the several articles and blogs I've used when deciding the winner, Tesseract was left in the dust by its competitors, although not far from EasyOCR, the results these two produced being way too inconsistent and subpar, with missing and breaking of words. The final battle was hard fought between PaddleOCR and MMOCR, both of which having really high accuracy and giving great results in general. Although, ultimately, I noticed a trend with MMOCR, making up words and awarding them very high confidence, which made me pick PedalOCR as the overall best option. But it should be noted that these tests were made using, in general, the base configurations of the algorithms and models, without training on datasets specific to the targeted problem, as I would rather not single-handedly create millions of entries for the models to train on, you know? And by adding the package, setting it up, and feeding it an input image, now I have a working OCR system. Also, you may have noticed something a bit off in that input image. No, not the logical instructions. Before them, literally. At the start of their respective lines. Those dashes, yeah, exactly. I realized that there is no way to have consistent indentation on paper, which, although simply decorative in some languages, is actually a key requirement for something like Python. So, in order to have a way of consistently representing tabs, I chose this approach, with each dash representing a tab. Of course, I made sure these are replaced with tabs only if they were placed at the start of the line. Which, not perfect, I know, but at least it's something. But now looky, the image is converted to fully functional Python code. And now it's time for the compilation part. Wait, no, never mind, I wanna do the handwriting generator thing. To get all the OCR stuff out of the way first, I moved on to the first part of the registration process, aka taking an image of a user's handwriting and parsing it to get a mapping of each letter and its representation. My approach was, and I'm sure someone with more experience will cringe, but also heroically post a better alternative, to take the input image, section it by the regions of interest, in this case the individual characters, take each of these sections and add padding to them so that there is a constant width and height of each character, something that will tremendously help when constructing the output image based on a text. And then take each of these icons, pass them through the OCR to get its interpretation, then adding it to a dictionary to be later stored and reused. Although, some things I noticed when implementing this were, firstly, that the shape of the icon, its height to width ratio, as well as the size, would influence the correctness of the results. And secondly, that the OCR model has issues interpreting individual characters, as it's generally trained on dictionaries of words instead of characters. Thus, uppercase I's, lowercase L's, or 1's often result in inconclusive outcomes, ending up as improperly attributed or completely ignored. So I guess that's something that could be improved some other time. Up next, because I was feeling ready to wrap up the user registration flow, I unknowingly found myself navigating to the Firebase dashboard, where I generated some credentials to access a Firestore database, downloaded the JSON containing those, then added the Firebase Python package, linked up the credentials and got a reference to the database. To register a new user, I created a users collection to which I added a new document whose ID I'd be using as the user's ID. Normally you'd want to implement a full authentication flow, maybe some sleek Google SSO coupled with a mechanism like JSON Web Tokens or sessions if you're feeling old school, but I figured it was overkill and rather unrelated to the main idea of the project. And finally, to this user document, I'd be appending an entries collection, which would contain documents representing each character and their representation, stored as bytes, achieved by some simple conversion method. Now, back to the compile endpoint. I currently can extract the text from an image while accounting for indentation. What's next is, given an image with the code and, optionally, an image with predefined input, then get the text of these along with the corresponding language, then feed them to an appropriate service that will spit out the output so that I can further turn it into an image using the user's handwriting. And, having worked with it in the past on some other projects, knowing it's an extraordinary product used by many competitive programming and online sandbox coding tools, added to the fact that it's free, open source, with a great deal of research put into it, I went for Judge Zero, or Judge O, I'm not sure. The service is built so that you can either get dedicated hosting or do it yourself locally, which of course I did, and behaves like a normal API once running, having various endpoints targeting compilation submissions, which can be single or batched, synchronous or asynchronous, authentication, authorization, information regarding languages, configurations, which, by the way, is done by a config file that offers a large array of options, from secrets used in auth to environment parameters like memory and time allocated per submission. Also, because each submission is run in an isolated, containerized manner, there are no security risks associated to hosting and managing the system on your personal computer. Damn, I sounded like someone shilling for some sales pitch of a scam product. But anyway, to set up this bad boy, you simply have to download the corresponding archive from the repo. By the way, there are two flavors, the default and extra, which, ignoring the huge pause moment I should take after saying that sentence, each map to different sets of languages and can be run simultaneously. simultaneously. But I figured the 40-something languages the default one supports were more than enough. And then, from the archive, you launch two configs using Docker Compose. Or you could spend an hour creating a PowerShell script to do all the setup automatically, never mind the fact that it's a one-time thing, completing the true programmer experience. But now, by taking the code, the input, if present, and the language ID, I can simply issue a request with the corresponding parameters. And, as a note, wait equals true means that it waits for the execution to finish and returns the result, as opposed to wait equals false, where it would grant a token for which you'd have to constantly verify execution has concluded. And I opted for the straightforward option because it's straightforward and more efficient if the user base is smaller. Neat thing to note. Also, the language ID is provided by the user, based on the list of available languages provided in the languages endpoint, which is basically a map where keys are the IDs and the values are the language names. Finally, to convert the output to handwriting, I simply took the provided user ID, retrieved the corresponding dictionary, then, going character by character, I added them to a canvas. And to make it pretty, I took note of each line, making sure the image is as wide as the longest line when converted to icons, as well as its height perfectly matches the number of lines multiplied by the height of an icon. And something that may interest you. When creating this endpoint, I found out that you can have both a JSON body and files in the same request, as by the HTTP standard, it wouldn't know what type to attribute to the request. So, additional information like the language ID and user ID were provided as query parameters. But if I were to make a production-grade app, I would make use of authentication headers as to not expose any critical information. But with this, the API, the epicenter of the project, its strongest pillar, la pièce de résistance, is complete. And so now it's time for the Flutter app. This section won't even be that long in the video, but trust me, it took me so long to finish. The register page has a single image input field, which is a custom widget I created that gets an image from the camera using the image picker package. When uploaded, the image unlocks the register button, which, when pressed, sends the request along with the image to the register endpoint in the API. If successful, it returns the user ID, which, with the help of a user management service based around shared preferences, which is pretty much local storage in the shape of a map, is saved on the user's device, to be used from now on when making any request to the backend, and then navigates to the main page. And by using GoRouter, another Flutter package, I made sure to automatically reroute the main page on startup, if the user had already registered on that device. On the main page, the user is greeted with a form that very explicitly states it takes an image of the code to be compiled, optionally the input for said code, and finally a dropdown for the user to select the languages from. When at least the code image and language are selected, the compiler button becomes active, which, when pressed, will call the compile endpoint with the necessary parameters. Finally, the image returned by the endpoint is automatically displayed in-app for the user to marvel at the superiority of my creation. And now, time for a test drive. I'll be using some handwriting fonts as to not scar you with my handwriting, which I'll be taking photos of using my phone. Also, just FYI, to communicate with the API from my phone, instead of localhost, I had to use the IP address of the network to which both my PC and phone are connected. Okay, now, first, registration. And now, time for the big test. First, a photo of the code. Now, one of the input. And finally, selecting the language. And for the moment of truth. Oh, hey, would you look at that? It actually worked. Haha. Damn, didn't expect that. I mean, of course it did. Just don't mind the fact that I purposefully didn't use any ones, uppercase I's or lowercase l's, as to not get blanks in the output.